Hello, hello, hello. I'm so sorry. It's been a couple of weeks since I posted. But I've been mega, mega, mega busy. Like another level busy. Ran a course last week with Australia and New Zealand, which was absolutely amazing. Met some incredible people. Had some unbelievable live sessions. Did a live entity release on day two, and there was a demon and an earthbound spirit to remove on that one. And then did a live full session on day three, and we had a energetic worm around the spine, a fairy that had gone dark that was working for a dark fairy prince, and did amazing galactic past life regression with that particular client who was a student on the course. I did actually also manage to Esdale somebody live on a live course. And for anybody who studied hypnotherapy or quantum healing or beyond quantum healing or SCHH, the Esdale state, as you will know, is otherwise known as the coma state, where you actually manage to talk somebody so deep in your session that you send them into a coma. And I managed to do that live on a course last week, which was pretty scary to say the least. But she came out after 5 minutes. It was okay. But I had a severe word with these guys upstairs afterwards for doing that to me on a live course. So what else have I got to tell you guys? The weather is really, really bad in the UK now. Well, it's all over the place, really. It's up and down. And it makes me feel really sad when summer ends. In fact, I could literally cry now just thinking about it. Whew, when the sun goes, I hate that. I don't deal with that very well. And so the only way I can get through it is to try and keep myself as high vibration as possible by wearing really, really loud, bright clothes. This is my oranges and lemon shirt that I've got on today. Trying to get out and about as much as possible to stop myself from feeling sad because I really, really do miss the sun. So I've been trying to keep myself as busy as possible. I have, for my eldest daughter's, my youngest daughter's birthday, actually, we bought the kids a ukulele each. Yeah, I actually did that. Don't know why. But one of my really, really good friends who I love to pieces, who's an amazing starseed, high frequency being, Mike B, he's been teaching my kids how to play ukulele. So they've been having a weekly ukulele lesson. And you can check Mike B out on YouTube. He's on YouTube as Solar Cantari. I will put this information in the body of the YouTube. But please do check him out. If you're thinking about having guitar lessons or ukulele lessons yourself, or you've got children that you would like to learn, Mike is superb. He is the best teacher ever, particularly for kids. I was sat listening to their first lesson that they did, and both my kids were like they absolutely loved him. They were hanging on to his every word. So yeah, check Solar Cantari out on YouTube. He is an incredible guitar player. And if for nothing else, if just to go on and listen to his music, then please do check that out. I've got three more courses that I'm running this year, and then I'm having a couple of months off to just unwind, and I'm going to write my third book in the Isadora Stone series because I've got all of the plot lines, and my kids are just driving me crazy because they want to read book three. So I've got to take December and January off to write that book. So I'm only running three more courses now until February next year. So I've got my next courses for Australia and New Zealand time zones are October the 20th, 21st and 22nd, or November the 24th, 25th and 26th. Now you can come on the course if you're not in Australia. It just means it's going to be an early start for you because I start at 8 a.m. and that's tea time in Australia. So if you want to come on the course and you can do an 8 a.m. start, living it large at 8 a.m. with me, then book on. You don't have to be in Australia or New Zealand. That's not, it's not a requirement. But the next Europe, UK and Africa specific time zone course is, apart from the one I'm running next week, which is full, so you can't book onto that one, is November the 10th, 11th, and 12th. And that's a 1 p.m. UK start. So it's 2 p.m. Europe, around the same time if you're in Africa. So if you are wanting to come and train with me, book on now, because I'm only running those three more courses until February next year. So I won't be taking any more new students for a couple of months. I've been getting a lot of divine masculine sessions recently, which is wonderful because normally the majority of my clients are female, but I am starting to get a lot more males, which is wonderful. I love the male sessions and lots of light warriors, lots of really, really exciting stories. I put one up, the actual video that I put up. I think it was a couple of weeks ago, about a guy who was a dragon. That was amazing, amazing one. And I've got one to share with you guys today, which is another super light warrior story. And I feel that this is very metaphorical for the times that we are living in right now. And that's why I wanted to share this one today. And I'll explain a little bit more about that as we get into it. And I have got another amazing divine masculine session to share with you guys as well. And that's probably going to be either next week or the week after. But that one is about a guy who is the guardian of the seed of creation, Gaia's heart on Earth. And that's got loads of ascension information in it. It is just an incredible session. So that's coming next week. But this week, I wanted to share this session because I found this session so powerful. I just wanted to cry all the way through it because I saw the metaphor within it. I saw the message within it, and I took that message and I held it close to my heart because I personally really, really needed to hear this message myself as well. And the reason for that is I am a light warrior. I am the light, but I am a light warrior. And what does that mean? It means that I can go and face the darkness. I can go toe to toe with the darkness while still knowing that I am the light and knowing that that darkness that I go toe to toe with is not going to have the ability to affect me, to change my vibration to a darker vibration because I am the light. Now, there's many, many types of light worker on this planet, and it takes all of us. It takes all of us and how we work together to do what we do. But there's many light workers that they'll look at my hypnotherapy technique and they'll say, oh no, that's not for me. Yeah, entity release. No, I'm not really up for that. I don't want to be, engaging with those types of energies. I'm not up for that, which is fine. That's absolutely fine. And it needs all types of light worker. You be one of those light workers over there that's shining so bright that doesn't even look at the darkness, that doesn't go anywhere near the darkness. But it does need those types of light workers like me and this guy here that will walk into the darkness whilst still being the light for the benefit of all, for the benefit of the light. Because if I came from a timeline myself personally where a future timeline, we had just ignored the darkness, let them do what they wanted to do, live and let them do what they want to do. We're just going to let them get on with it. And because we did that, the darkness came out of balance, consumed everything in the universe until there was only a small group of light left and they almost snuffed us out. And that's why I came back in time to be actually inside of Gaia when she was just starting to express herself in form on the surface. And I've been with Gaia throughout her entire journey. Through all of this, I've been there with her because my role is to make sure that through the annals of time, that the higher timelines are always followed. That if there's any incarnation that I can take that will allow those higher timelines to be born, then that is what I do. And that's why I do what I do now. And so it has to have those really strong lights that are so strong in who and what they are that it doesn't matter what dark energy or spirit you go up against. You still know that you are the light. And you also know that because you are connected to the light, you have the power and the energy to go up against that spirit and either get rid of it, convert it, like in doing entity release, what I do in this job, in this now moment. I negotiate with the spirits. We get them to find the spark. If they're a demon or a dark energy, we get them to make the spark bigger and we get them to cross over into the light. If they're an earthbound spirit, I'll take them back to the last day of their life, get them to realize that they're dead, and then cross them over at that point. But it takes these really strong light workers who aren't afraid of the darkness to do that work. And if we didn't do that work, the entire universe would come out of balance. So you can't ignore the darkness just because you are the light. You can't. Because if you do, the darkness will consume you. And that's why I do what I do. That's why I day in, day out, deal with these dark energies and heal people. Take energy parasites off them. Take them to the different parts of their quantum space so that they can find out who they are. Because you have to acknowledge the darkness in order to step into your light. So I loved this session because I felt it was also very metaphorical for where we are on Earth right now, given my particular journey. You know, if we had have decided in that future timeline to just think, oh, well, you know, the darkness has come out of balance. I still don't want to look at it, though. I'm still going to carry on being the light over here. Then so many planets and galaxies and species would have died. You have to acknowledge the darkness. You have to stand up to it. Otherwise, it will pervade and it will consume you. And this is what we're doing on planet Earth right now. We are the ones who came and said no. No. The darkness doesn't get to do what it's doing to all of these innocent beings on planet Earth right now. I am going to be the light. I'm going to do what I can do in this now moment to shine and to wake people up and to heal people and to show them there is a better way, a different way than how we're being steered right now on planet Earth. And I really feel that this particular session is a metaphor for what we are experiencing now on planet Earth. So I will stop waffling now, get off my soapbox, and I will begin to read the session. This guy is fantastic because he does not need anything from me. He's one of those amazing people that once he's in it, he just takes himself through it. He just talks himself through it. So it's basically, it's going to read like a story. So here we go. I'm walking between some rocks, but there's grass on the rocks. If I look up, I can see trees growing out of the rocks on either side. As I walk further down, the rocks are becoming quite sheer-sided and the grass is starting to disappear. The rocks are very, very grey, dark grey, and the path is still there. The steps are beginning to break up now and it's just like it's polished stone, uneven underfoot. The sides of the rock are quite close, like a ravine, and it's very polished, either by a river running down there or it's been used many, many times before. It's the action of something brushing against the rock that's made it smooth. There's no jagged edges. And I'm walking between these rocks very steadily now, very steadily, as the floor is quite polished and it could be slippy. And then I come to a rock wedge in front of me and it splits the path in two. Now you can tell straight away from that this client has got excellent inner vision. I mean, he can see everything. The level of detail that he's giving here is superb. And I just get really excited because as a practitioner, I know I'm going to have a really fantastic session and he's going to breathe life into this for me, which he did. I was literally on the edge of my seat. I will continue. And as you look at that rock wedge, that splits the path in two. And then he cuts me off and he carries on. On the right, it goes into a dark opening, a cavern. So that's to the right. And to the left, it starts to rise slightly. And I can see that the path is made of flowers. But it's not flowers. They're seashells. But they look like flowers, all different colours. And it's brighter because it's going up. So I have to choose which way to go. The dark opening to the cavern sends shivers down my spine. And I'm tempted to go on the path that is made of seashells that looks like flowers. But I feel that there's something. The easiest way to go is the path that is made of light. But I feel that there's something in that cave. There's something in that cave, that dark cavern to the right, that I have to conquer. I have to deal with it. Allow yourself to connect to that feeling. I don't want to make a mistake. I feel as though everybody takes the path to the left, which is light. But somebody should take the path to the right and deal with the darkness that's down there. It's not being dealt with. Everybody looks to the light as the easiest way out, but the darkness needs to be dealt with. There's something there that needs to be destroyed. Because I feel it's not just a choice of take the left path because it's the right path to take. Because what's at the end of that path? You can never live in peace at the end of that path of light until you go to the right and destroy what's in that cave. That could come up the path of light at any minute and destroy everything up there. Destroy the light that's at the end of the path. I feel fear. But I feel as though fear is not the answer. I feel as though I must overcome my fear and deal with whatever is at the end of that darkness for the sake of the light that is at the end of the other path. So I thought that was so poignant. You know, he understands that the easiest way to the light and the way he's going to feel better is to just go up the light path. But somebody's got to address what's lurking in the darkness. And that's how we ended up on planet Earth, is it not? We are the beings that said, somebody's got to address what lurks in the darkness. And what does that say about us when we consider that? What does that say about us? That we are the beings that chose to go into the dark abyss rather than just carry on skipping up the path of light. It makes me feel really proud. And so he then starts breathing heavily, and I can tell that some sort of emotion is coming up. So I say to him, allow that emotion to flow through, allow yourself to release it, feel it and release it. Tell me what you feel. I can see myself now. I am tall. I've got short, wavy blonde hair. I've got armor on. Armor that's made of gold. It's not normal gold. It's the hardest gold that there is. Nothing can pierce that armor. I have a sword in my hand that is bright, golden, yellow. It is so bright, it looks as though it's molten or in flame. And I also have a shield. The shield is a long shield and it's curved and pointed at the bottom. It has two spikes coming out of the bottom, so it's like a weapon. And the top, it's made of two curves, so it's got three points at the top. And in the middle is a green emerald surrounded by red rubies. It's padded on the inside so that where my arm goes through it, if I took a strike, then the padding will absorb the shock, and the sword fits my hand as though it's been made to fit my hand. It feels as though it's glued to my hand. And I've got sandals with armor plates over them going up my leg, and a red tunic-like skirt under the armor and armor knee pads. So my legs are bare in places, but the armour comes down and there's like a skirt at the bottom of the armour and it's golden chainmail. I choose to go into the darkness. And as I walk into the darkness, the light from my sword lights up the cavern. And there's also light reflected off the shield as well that starts to light up the cavern. And it's like a rounded passageway. It's not really a cavern. It's a tunnel that goes downwards. It's a round tunnel. It's not really got any walls to it. It's just a black tunnel. I stare back at the entrance that I've just come through, and it's not there anymore now. It's black behind me. I still move forwards, but then realise that I'm not really moving forwards. I'm in some kind of a doorway or passageway. The glow from my sword lights up a doorway. It's a huge wooden oak doorway. No, it's not oak. It's just dark wood and it's rounded. It's got grey metal strips, a frame, so the wood is kind of embedded into a grey metal frame. And there are two round latch handles. But the door is slightly open, so I kick out with my foot and I kick the door wider for me to fit through. As I walk through the door slams shut behind me. And at this point, I was like, oh my God, what's going to happen next? Something darts down towards me, a tail or a spike or something, and my shield seems to have a mind of its own and it's already up there and it deflects it. They are like tendrils, like wedge-shaped spikes on the end. But every time one comes at me, it just hits the armor. My armor seems to move into position to stop it. It's like the armor controls itself. Like the armor has consciousness, like it's alive. I see something big, a tail or a tendril coming towards it. My sword slashes out quick and cuts it to pieces, and I see red. But it's like crystalline inside of it. The texture inside. There's no blood. It's like light, but dark light. It's not bright light. It's dark light, and it's red. And then it just spills out onto the floor like a gush of blood, but it's not blood. It's solidified light, like condensed light. And this tail thing recedes back into the darkness. And then I, with the sword still in my hand, I press or rub the green emerald in the middle of the shield. And a light shines out from it like a cone. Like a cone of light, and it lights up everything in front of me. And there it is. There is this huge black beast, like a devil, but huge. It opens its eyes and mouth, and it is yellow inside. Its mouth is yellow, its eyes are yellow, and it just stares at me. And then it decides to start to attack again. It's got all of these snake-like tendrils coming off of its body. It keeps attacking, but every time I stand there with complete confidence as I know who I am, I have my armor, I have my sword, I have my shield, and they protect me. It's like I am invincible. And that the fear that I had of the split in that path initially was unnecessary because this evil thing, this very powerful evil thing, it felt like it couldn't harm me. But I knew I was there to harm it. It started to shrink back, but I go forward and I'm quite minuscule by comparison of this thing. And I can feel the pain and suffering that this creature has got inside of it. But it's not its pain and suffering. It is the pain and suffering of all kinds of creatures, all different creatures that this thing has devoured or entrapped into its evil. And this cannot be allowed to continue. It cannot. And so all of a sudden, I start to grow in stature. I get larger and larger and taller, and my armor grows with me, and my sword grows with me. And this thing raises its head upwards, and it's like the yellow inside of it is actually fire. And it breathes out this intense fire towards me, and I can feel the heat, and it's scorching everything. And I just strike out at it with my sword, and it puts up the tendrils and its tail to protect itself. But my sword is made of pure golden light, and it cuts through everything. Bits of this creature fall to the floor. But I know to finish it off, I have to take its head. I've got to destroy that head. Not just separate it. That's what I do again. I swing with my sword of light and I take its head. The most ear-piercing shriek shakes this cavern that we are in. The place is vibrating and bits of the cavern are falling off. And its head falls to the floor with fire spilling out of it. And I bring down my sword and I chop it and chop it. And I realise that all I am doing is cutting up the evil into smaller pieces. And then I remember my shield with the rubies and the emerald and the two prongs on the bottom. And I see this things. It's like a light blue, massive brain on the floor. And I bring this shield down with the two points of this shield straight down into the brain. And it explodes like a balloon popping, splatters all over the walls and everywhere. And that's it. It is finished. It is gone. It is dead. And I look around, and the bits of this thing, all of its tails and tendrils, just start to wither away. And they, as they wither, the red light comes out like little pockets of dark red light all over the place, thousands of them. And they just go poof and disappear. And then I look around and I walk backwards towards the doors. And I rest my sword against my shield. And I open one of the ringed latches and pull the door towards me. It's very heavy, but I am now of great stature. And I pull it towards me. And I find myself kind of shrinking back to the size I was before. So I can walk back through the door. I walk through the door. Just one of the doors that I have opened, one is still shut. And I slip through sideways with my shield and sword, and I walk back through the door. And as I walk back through the door, I see the daylight outside. So I scramble up to get to the opening. But it doesn't seem to be there when I get to the opening. I'm still in this passageway, and it's still dark. I look back behind me, and there's a gold and red. At first I thought it was a dragon, but it's not a dragon, it's something else. It's more like a lizard, and it's huge, and it's got spikes on it and huge teeth, but no eyes, or its eyes are really dark and I can't see them. Dark sockets. It's obviously come here to kill me. Tell me more about what happens next. It's coming into the huge passageway, and I'm just stood there still with my armor, my sword and shield, and it's staring at me. It's not attacking me though. Yet it's an evil thing. Yet it's not attacking. I'm wondering whether I should attack it, but it does not seem to be giving me cause to attack it. So I speak to it. And just say to it that I want to go back. I feel as though I've passed through some dark portal and I'm in the underworld now where evil resides. And I feel like this creature has the power to open up that portal and send me back. And I ask it why it's not attacking me. And it just says, I just want to be left alone. My master has gone now. I cannot exist in any place other than here. And I need you to leave me alone. And if you agree, I will stay here and I will allow you to go back. But if you cannot leave me alone, then I cannot send you back. So I ask it, if I leave you alone, then you can just cause more pain and suffering, just like your master. And I assume that that master that it refers to is the evil creature that I have just destroyed. And he reassures me, I will stay here. I will never leave here. I have nowhere else to go. Just leave me be. And I look at this thing, and I don't know what it is, or whether it's just been something that's been used by the evil beast that I slayed to run errands or collect things. But this creature here was not made from evil. It has just been controlled by the evil. It was a beast that lived here. And so I agree. But I warn this being, this creature, that if it ever comes up to the surface and does anything evil, then I will return and I will destroy it. And all the time that I'm talking to this creature, it's skirting around the edges of this huge domed cavern with outlets all the way around, like it is circling me, like it's stalking me, trying to take the measure of me, but then it stops. And it says, look up. And I look up above me, and there is a shaft of light. And as I look back down, he just says to me, goodbye, my friend. And this shaft of light comes down and surrounds me and pulls me into it. And the darkness just closes up behind me. And this shaft of light pulls me up and materializes me at the top of the path with the coloured shells. And from the top of this path, now where I stand, I am in like a circle, a stone circle. The stones are not very high, about 4 feet high, like pillars, small, narrow pillars of stone. And I stand there, and I look out from where I am. It is high up, it is a great vantage point. And I look out at the land, all around me, and it is so beautiful, so lush, so green. There is an incredible ocean, beautiful golden sands, so beautiful. An emotion wells up inside of me, nearly takes my breath. That is what was at the top of the path of light. And if I hadn't have taken the path to the right and destroyed that evil would have come up and spread its tendrils all through this beautiful land and turned it into evil. So this paradise has now been saved. The choice that was laid before me was to take the path of beauty or take the path of darkness. And the virtuous ones would have taken the path of light. But I knew I had to take the path of darkness in order for the light to be able to shine. Wow. What an incredible, incredible session. And that is so metaphorical for the times that we are in now. As these light beings that we are, starseeds, light workers, however you choose to identify and describe yourself, we chose to come into this place that is beyond dark. And it takes a lot of courage to do that, a lot of courage. And so don't ever forget that. You know, if you're having a bad day and you feel low and you feel sad and you look around at everybody around you and it feels like everybody's fast asleep, don't forget you were the same as that warrior dressed in gold with the flaming sword and the shield that looked at those two paths and decided that somebody had to go into the dark space to tackle what lurked in there in order that the rest of the universe can enjoy the beauty at the top of the path of light. And that is the ins and outs of my technique, basically. That is what I do in my life. As the light, you don't want to have to look at the darkness. You don't want to have to tackle it. Yes, it fills you with fear, but somebody has to do it. And the only way that we can move forwards and upwards and onwards with our ascension is if we help all of those light workers and light warriors and awakened beings who have the energy attachments attached to them, help them to take those off so that those energies cross, so we're raising the vibration of the client, raising the vibration of the planet, helping more souls cross over, be discovered, be saved. And yes, it doesn't feel comfortable all of the time to do that work. But those of us who are strong enough, that are strong enough within our light, know that we are light no matter what. We know that we bring the force of God. We bring the force of Source. We bring the force of the archangels, of the ascended masters, of the high frequency star beings into this realm. And we anchor that energy into this realm. And we are the cleanup crew within the third dimensional space that enables the higher level beings, that gives them the, yes, free will choice. The client has signed up to see me, so that gives the clients free will choice to have these energies, these entities removed from them, so that we can all ascend, so that we can all progress, so that we can all have our vibrations raised. And so I want you to think about that really carefully as you move through your life moving forwards. Don't forget that you are one of those exceptional beings that decided that somebody had to acknowledge, tackle, and slay the darkness that lay inside of that cavern. And that's why we're here on planet Earth. And so I'm going to leave you with that thought today. I hope you're all really, really well. The next time that I do a vlog like this, it will be a fantastic session that I did. Another divine masculine warrior that has been defending our planet. And I want to see more of that. So all of you divine masculine souls, please do book a session with me. Reach out. Let's connect. Because I'd love to get some more of your stories on my channel. Till the next time I connect with you guys, make sure you keep vibrating high. I love you all so much. Take care. Bye-bye.